Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Traveller's Guide to the Stars by Les Johnson, narrated by Michael Page. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. Life is a journey, and sometimes so is a book. This book's journey began when I was asked to lead NASA's Interstellar Propulsion Research Project in 1999 and began voraciously reading just about every technical book written on the topic of interstellar travel. I was already somewhat prepared for the job. Being a physicist, I knew I could understand the basics and decipher the mathematics that underlies the various propulsion technologies that had been proposed over the 40 years or so that scientists had seriously been studying the topic. Having grown up reading at least one science fiction book, novel or anthology, each week from middle school through graduate school, I was mentally prepared to think out of the box. Or so I thought. The Interstellar Propulsion Technology Research Project was funded for about 2 years before NASA decided to use the funds for other purposes, but not before I became a convert. In my tenure managing the experiments on technologies ranging from solar, laser, and microwave sails to nuclear fission, fusion, and antimatter, I came to believe that going to the stars is something that can actually be done. We may not yet know how to engineer and build the necessary systems, but there is no fundamental scientific reason the systems and technologies described in this book cannot become a reality. With the project's demise, my working on interstellar travel technologies at NASA ended, but not my personal involvement. Outside of my NASA duties, a close-knit group of my friends and I founded the Tennessee Valley Interstellar Workshop, TVIW, a non-profit educational organization with the goal of fostering future interstellar travel. TVIW has been far more successful than we ever envisioned and has now sponsored 7 symposia, granted thousands of dollars in scholarships to deserving college students who share our common interest, and overseen the publication of multiple original research papers in prestigious science journals. TVIW morphed into the Interstellar Research Group, about which you can learn more on their website, www.irg.space. That is my journey. But what about this book? It results from my passionate belief that we humans will one day send our descendants to live on a planet orbiting another star, a first step toward taking Earth life to the rest of the universe. It is a goal to which I want to make a contribution and which has consumed a good portion of my personal life these last few years. My agent and I proposed an earlier version of this book to various publishers 10 years ago, but there was little interest. That was before exoplanet discoveries began making headlines, before SpaceX and Blue Origin began revolutionizing access to space, and before the advent of organizations like 100 Year Starship and breakthrough initiatives entered the consciousness of the science-literate public. Instead, I co-edited, with New York Times best-selling author Jack McDevitt, an anthology of original science fiction stories mixed with popular science non-fiction essays called Going Interstellar, Build Starships Now, which was published by Bain Books, a science fiction publisher. The anthology was successful and eventually led to another interstellar-themed science fiction, science fact anthology, also from Bain Books, called Stellaris, People of the Stars, which I co-edited with Robert Hampson. On a bit of a lark, and without even my agent being aware, I created and submitted a book proposal, for this book, to Princeton University Press, and to my great surprise, they quickly responded with interest. After many telephone discussions with my primary point of contact at Princeton, Jessica Yao, we arrived at what is before you. The Traveller's Guide to the Stars is intended to be readable, accessible, and understandable by anyone, not just scientists and engineers. There are enough technical books out there on this subject, I did not need to write another. No, this book is intended for the people who will really make the journeys discussed herein a possibility, the people who will have to advocate for the work to be funded and who will participate vicariously, if not personally, when the journeys begin. We will not get to the stars unless society supports going, and that means all of us. The journey is only beginning, and I want to leave you with what has become my life's vision, thanks to one of those otherwise excruciating management workshops that are fashionable in large organizations. At one of these workshops, I do not recall exactly when, we were asked to articulate in one sentence our professional career goals. Mine was simple, and I have since quoted it many times. When future human settlers on an exoplanet write a history book describing how their new world came to be explored and settled, I would like for my technical work to be cited as a footnote. This book is another step on my journey to becoming that footnote. I hope you enjoy it and learn a few things along the way. A note to the listener about units of measurement. Throughout the book, I will use a mixture of metric and English, now rarely just American, units. Why? Because when I am performing my day job at NASA, that's how I think, in units of grams and kilograms, meters and millimeters, and so on. But when I am at home, I think and work in inches, pounds, and miles. My choice in any particular instance may to you seem arbitrary, but to me, the units used will reflect how I think about the world and how I suspect many of my readers in the USA do as well. Introduction. Humans have, since our beginning, looked at the stars and asked the big questions. Who am I? Why am I here? What or who is out there? We are close to being able to answer some of these questions as our species continues its exploration of space and prepares to take the first steps toward the stars. The stars are more than beautiful points of light in the night sky. Far, far away, they harbor new worlds. It is difficult to believe that until the early 1990s, the only planets we knew scientifically existed in the universe were those orbiting our sun. With the growing list of known exoplanets, some of which appear to lie in the habitability zones of their parent stars, there are many beginning to wonder about how we might someday travel there to explore them. Despite the optimism of the early space age, our progress toward this goal has been slower than many anticipated. This is not just for lack of trying, the challenges are daunting. The nearest star, Proxima Centauri, is about 4.2 light years away. That is, it takes light, traveling at about 186,000 miles per second, approximately 300,000 kilometers per second, over 4 years to make the journey. For most people, this is a meaningless measurement. How many of us can truly relate to the speed of light? To illustrate the difficulty, consider distances much closer and the challenges we face in traversing them. The Voyager spacecraft, launched in 1977, are the most distant emissaries yet launched from Earth. Voyager 1 is roughly 156 astronomical units, AU, away as of this writing, 156 times the Sun-to-Earth distance of approximately 93 million miles, and it has taken it more than 44 years to get there. For up-to-date information about Voyager's location, check out the NASA website, voyager.jpl.nasa.gov/mission/status. If the Voyagers were traveling in the correct direction, then it would take them about 70,000 years to reach Proxima Centauri, and that is the nearest star. The duration of a viable interstellar journey must be measured in years, not millennia, for such missions to be undertaken. Propulsion is not the only challenge. How would such a spacecraft communicate across such vast distances? Far away from any star, how can the craft be powered on its journey through the darkness between the stars? Traveling at the speeds necessary to shorten the trip time will increase the risk of damage to the craft from collision with interstellar dust, a potentially catastrophic event when traveling at a significant fraction of the speed of light. Fortunately, nature appears to allow rapid interstellar travel without having to invoke new physics. Propulsion technologies based on nuclear fusion, antimatter, and laser-beamed energy all appear to be physically possible, but the engineering of systems of the scale required is well beyond today's capabilities. If we are to undertake this ultimate voyage, we must first inhabit much of our own solar system. Interstellar travel will require new technologies, a new ethical framework for exploration that will enable us to avoid repeating the mistakes of the past, and a visionary mindset that is reminiscent of the construction of the great cathedrals of Europe, the notion that a project begun today may not be complete for many generations to come. And then there is the question of why. Why should we travel to the stars? For that matter, why should we explore space at all? In the first 50-plus years of the space age, we now have compelling and nearly universally accepted reasons for the exploration and development of space near Earth and in Earth orbit. Weather satellites allow meteorologists to provide fairly accurate weather forecasts days and weeks into the future. They also help us predict the paths of hurricanes and cyclones, saving lives. Communications satellites knit the world together, allowing us to know what's happening all over the world in real time. They relay our television channels and some cell phone conversations, while large constellations of communications satellites are beginning to provide broadband internet accessible everywhere around the globe. Spy satellites help keep the peace by allowing countries to monitor one another's military activities, nearly removing the possibility of surprise attacks, an important part of strategic safety in our nuclear weapons-armed world. Global positioning system satellites allow us to navigate to new places and are essential to keeping our highly interdependent world and global economy functioning. Space near Earth is now indispensable to our daily lives and well-being. Many advocates believe that the next logical step is the development of cislunar space, the region between Earth and the Moon. With NASA and other countries planning to send people to the Moon in the coming years, there is an expectation that new products and services will arise there just as they did in Earth orbit. The argument is then extended out into the solar system and ultimately to the stars. As a scientist, I believe there is a valid reason for exploring space, including space beyond our meager solar system, that has nothing to do with economics or tangible return. To learn more about the universe, what's out there, and how it works. All of the engineering we use to keep our 21st century lives functioning stemmed from scientists in earlier eras asking similar fundamental questions that, at the time, may or may not have had an obvious economic return or application. Expanding human knowledge is as valid a reason as any other. There are objections to these views and some sticky ethical questions that arise when thinking about our expansion into space and then on to the stars. Many of these are addressed in Chapter 3, Putting Interstellar Travel into Context. Interstellar travel is possible, just extremely difficult. Are we willing to accept the challenge? 1. The universe awaits. Space is big. You just won't believe how vastly, hugely, mind-bogglingly big it is. I mean, you may think it's a long way down the road to the chemists, but that's just peanuts to space. Douglas Adams, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Until the early 1990s, the only people who were sure there were planets circling other stars were science fiction fans who witnessed Captains Kirk, Picard, Janeway, Sisko, and others visit strange new worlds each week on television, or thrilled as Luke Skywalker and Princess Leia restored order in a galaxy far, far away. Okay, not really, but I'm not far off. Until then, astronomers were fairly confident that planets circled other stars, but there was no direct evidence of their existence, only the assumption that our solar system was not unique among the many stars that populated our galaxy, the Milky Way, and the many others that fill the universe. Giordano Bruno, 1548 to 1600, an Italian philosopher, postulated that the Sun was but one star among many, and that around these other stars were planets. This and other scientific heresy got him burned alive in Rome. The first extrasolar planets, or exoplanets, discovered were found in extremely inhospitable locations orbiting pulsars. Pulsars are rapidly rotating neutron stars that emit regular pulses of radiation, including radio waves, gamma rays, and X-rays, at rates of about 1,000 pulses per second. A pulsar's pulse rate is regular and predictable, so much so that they are being considered for use in celestial navigation. Tiny variations in the pulses led to the inference that the observed irregularity was caused by orbiting planets, and voila, the first indirect evidence of exoplanets. Optical observers caught up to the accuracy needed for similar feats, and shortly thereafter, astronomers were also detecting extrasolar planets around mostly sun-like stars via the Doppler shifts produced by the planet's perturbations of the stars. Light emitted or reflected from objects moving away from the observer is stretched out to slightly longer wavelengths due to the object's motion. Light emitted or reflected from an object moving toward the observer is analogously compressed to shorter wavelengths. The amount of elongation or compression depends on the object's speed. This is called a Doppler shift, and it is the reason the radar guns used by police can so quickly determine if you are speeding while driving. Basically, just as a star's gravity tugs on the planets circling it to keep them in orbit, so do the masses of the planets pull on the star. Given the mass differences, the gravitational pull on the star is extremely small compared with the reverse, but it is not zero. Therefore, as a planet orbits a star, the planet will pull on it, causing the star to move slightly toward the planet, inducing it to wobble. Since the star is constantly emitting light, the wobble can be detected as a small Doppler shift in the light's wavelength. These measurements by themselves gave only lower limits to the planet's masses, but were an important clue to the abundance of Jupiter-mass planets. In about 2000, astronomers began finding exoplanets using the transit method. The best way to understand how this works is to think about a solar eclipse. When the Moon passes between Earth and the Sun along the line of sight, the Moon casts a shadow on Earth that you can see. Now imagine looking into our solar system from outside the orbit of Pluto with one of the eight planets crossing your field of view as you stare at the Sun. With sensitive instruments, you would see the light from the Sun dim slightly as the planet passes between your instrument and the Sun, blocking some of the light. If you hold your position long enough, let's say several Earth years, then you could theoretically see the same planet complete multiple orbits around the Sun, causing a dimming that regularly repeats. If you were to change your viewing direction to look at a star other than the Sun and have even more sensitive instruments, then you would see the dimming of that star caused by any planets that orbit it along your line of sight, the transit method. Of course, given the distances and the relative sizes of planets as compared to the stars they are transiting, the instruments needed to see the dimmed light must be quite sensitive, and the data processing software required is complex. The analogy I like to use is that of trying to determine the size of a mosquito, the planet, flying in front of your car's headlights, the star, while you stare at it on a dark night. There are many other methods now used to find and characterize exoplanets, and multiple space missions have flown for just that purpose. As a result, and according to NASA's Exoplanet Exploration website, there are now more than 4,000 confirmed exoplanets, and more than 5,000 additional potential exoplanets awaiting independent confirmation. And now the story gets even more interesting. Among these exoplanets, there are several that are near Earth size and orbiting their parent stars in that star's habitable zone. This means that not only is the planet similar in size to Earth, some larger, like Neptune, some smaller, like Mars, but it is in a region around the star where the temperature is not too hot nor too cold for liquid water and the chemistry essential for life as we know it to exist. Scientists have identified about 60 such potentially habitable planets. Given that we have only been able to search among the stars nearest to Earth, and that there are about 100 billion stars in the Milky Way alone, using these statistics, the current best estimate for the number of near-Earth-sized planets in habitable zones around other stars is, drum roll, between 11 billion and 40 billion. Wow. That is a lot of potential real estate waiting to be discovered, mapped, and explored. How soon can we go? The answer to this question is not something to which a specific date or range of dates can be assigned, at least not yet. To answer it, we need first to understand how far away these exoplanets are and more about what lies between us and them. Let's start by thinking about the vastness of space and our notions of infinity. If you want to touch the infinite, go outside on a cloudless night and look at the stars. Okay, the universe is not really infinite, but for all practical purposes, note I say practical, it is as close to the infinite as we will likely ever see or know. You will have to put down your phone, ebook reader, or other gadget and find a spot away from bright lights so your eyes can get adjusted to the darkness. All right, this will be a challenge for city dwellers, but that is not an excuse. Once you are there, look up and find as many pinpoints of light in the sky as you can. A few of the lights you see will be planets in our solar system, like Mars or Jupiter, reflecting light from the sun. Others will be stars or collections of stars that, like the sun, emit their own light. Stand or sit quietly and think about the light you see. The particles of light, called photons, that impinge on your eyes have been traveling through space a long time, hundreds, thousands, and perhaps millions of years, and they end their journey through deep space when they reach your eyes and touch you. In the vacuum of space, light travels at about 186,000 miles per second, 300,000 kilometers per second. On a sunny day, the light that illuminates the world around us traveled through space for about 8 minutes at a speed of 186,000 miles per second from the time it left the sun until it touched your skin and began giving you a sunburn. 8 minutes. Since you are now outside looking at the night sky, consider the light reflected from Jupiter, the largest planet in the solar system. Jupiter is typically one of the brightest objects in the night sky because it is so large. 11 Earths can line up across its equator, and therefore reflects a lot of light. At its closest, Jupiter is just over 365 million miles from Earth, and the light you see reflecting from it took about 41 minutes to get from the sun to the planet, and nearly 33 minutes to travel from the planet to your eyes, for a total of about 74 minutes. The most distant planet, Neptune, is so far away that it takes the light reflecting from it about 4 hours to touch your eyes. Compared to the stars, these distances to the planets are small. If you live in a big city, that might be all you can see, even on a clear night. The combination of street lights, automobiles, and light leaking from the apartments and homes around you, combined with the humidity of the air, might make it nearly impossible to see what those blessed with dark skies can see from more rural areas. Away from the lights of civilization, the average person can see about 2,000 stars in the sky. Among the closest, easily visible to those living in the southern hemisphere, are Alpha Centauri A and B. The light they emit travels through space for more than 4 years to reach Earth and touch your eyes. 4 years, and these stars are relatively close to us. To make discussion of these immense distances easier, astronomers call the distance light travels in a year a light year. On this scale, Alpha Centauri A and B are 4.35 light years, LY, away. If we were limited to seeing the stars using only our eyes, Then we would be seeing objects that are many times more distant than Alpha Centauri A and B, but we would be missing the bigger picture, the much bigger picture, that is the universe in which we live. Early telescopes allowed people to look at the reflected light from the planets and see that they were big, round objects like Earth orbiting the Sun at ever greater distances. They also allowed people to see many more stars than are visible to the naked eye, including some fuzzy, spiral-shaped objects, generically called nebulae, which were so lovingly and systematically categorized by Charles Messier, and are now known as Messier objects. Until Edwin Hubble came along, astronomers considered what we now know as galaxies to be some of these nebulae. Exploded stars within our own galaxy were also nebulae. In fact, given the limitations of those early telescopes, just about anything that looked like a fuzzy cloud of dust or gas was labeled a nebula. Nebulae were everywhere, and there wasn't much to distinguish between the various types. In the early 1920s, while using the 100-inch mirror at the Mount Wilson Observatory, Hubble took the highest resolution images to date of the Andromeda Nebula and discovered that it was actually an extremely distant clumping of many stars, like our Milky Way galaxy. A few years later, he calculated that this new galaxy must be at least 10 times more distant than the most distant stars within our Milky Way. Telescopes improved, and many more nebulae were found to be, in fact, distant galaxies. Thanks to modern telescopes, including one named after Edwin Hubble flying in space over 300 miles above in Earth orbit, we now know that there are billions of galaxies in the universe, each containing billions of stars, and we can see many of them, thanks to our telescopes here on the ground and in space. We now know that the multi-billion star cluster that is our own galaxy, the Milky Way, is about 100,000 light-years across. In other words, it takes light about 100,000 years to travel from one side of the Milky Way to the other. One of the nearest galaxies to ours, Andromeda, is nearly 2.5 million light-years away. If you are stargazing on a clear, dry night, far from city lights, then one of the tiny stars you can see is not a star at all. It is the Andromeda Galaxy. Keeping in the theme of touching eternity, consider that the light from Andromeda that touches your eye, touches you, traveled through space more than 2 million years. When you see it, you are truly touching the nearly infinite. If Alpha Centauri A and B are the nearest stars, and Andromeda is one of the nearest galaxies, what about the farthest? Similar to how our eyes are limited to seeing only about 2,000 stars, and the early telescopes were limited to seeing mostly the planets and a few more stars, our current telescopes are limited by current technological abilities. Seen by the Hubble Space Telescope in 2015, EGS-8P7 is one of the most distant galaxies ever observed at 13.2 billion light-years. If you are like me, and I suspect most people, some astronomers excluded maybe, then the differences in these distances are almost meaningless and completely outside your everyday experience. How can anyone comprehend the difference between the distance to the Sun at 8 light minutes and the distance to Neptune, 4 light hours, with the distance to Alpha Centauri A and B, let alone Andromeda? For fun, let's try. First, let's invent our own measuring stick. We start with a scale developed by astronomers, the astronomical unit, AU, which is the Sun-to-Earth distance of 93 million miles. Using this scale, Earth is 1 AU from the Sun. Let's visualize this by creating a scale model of the solar system that will fit into a typical classroom, with 1 AU corresponding to 1 foot, about 30 centimeters, and use this distance to build a mental model of the solar system and beyond. I chose to use the imperial measurement system because my shoe size measures almost exactly 1 foot, which is very convenient. I have walked out this solar system scaling in many classrooms and lecture halls. Earth is 1 AU, 1 foot from the Sun. Therefore, on this scale, Mars is half a foot AU away, and Neptune 30 feet AU. Note that we regularly launch rockets to Mars, and it takes them approximately 7 months to cover the Earth to Mars distance of half a foot. Voyager took about 12 years to reach Neptune. On this scale, the nearest stars, Alpha Centauri A and B, would be 268,770 feet, or about 51 miles, about 82 kilometers, away. And those are the nearest stars. The best attempt at visualizing the distances involved on a single image can be seen in Figure 1.1, which can be found in the print version of this book. Significant solar system objects are specifically labeled, as are the approximate locations of the Voyager spacecraft and the stars in the Centauri system. The part that is a bit difficult to understand, and is also the only way the vast distances involved can be compressed and viewable on the graphic, is the horizontal axis. Each distance increment on the axis is 10 times farther than the previous one. I will leave it to you to figure out how far away the Andromeda galaxy lies on this scale. The bottom line, space is big. Really big. Unimaginably big. How then can we ever hope to bridge the gap and visit planets circling other stars? Again, by thinking big, as I will explain. Interstellar travel is not for the timid. We need to consider that there is more than just the distance when we contemplate traveling across the void to visit a planet circling another star. Contrary to what you may think, space is not just a vacuum with a few planets and stars dropped here and there. We need to consider what else lies between us and where we want to go before we can even begin seriously thinking of going there. First, space is not empty, just almost empty. In our solar system, the Sun sits at the center and serves as not only the source of heat and light that gives the solar system life, but also as the gravitational anchor around which the 8 planets, 5 known dwarf planets — Pluto is considered a dwarf planet, as are Ceres, Haumea, Makemake, and Eris — as well as hundreds of thousands of asteroids and comets orbit. The Sun is by far the largest object in the solar system, with a diameter across which you could place more than 109 Earths side to side and more than 1 million Earths in its volume. Almost all of the mass in the solar system, 99.8%, is in the Sun. Jupiter, the largest planet, could contain only a paltry 1,300 Earths in its volume. Of the remaining planets, some are larger than Earth, some smaller. When you combine the masses of all the planets, dwarf planets, asteroids, and comets, you would have most, but not all, of the remaining 0.2% of the solar system's mass. It is this small fraction of a percent that might cause problems for interstellar spacecraft as they exit the solar system and enter another one, and perhaps to a lesser extent in the void between the stars. Left over from when the solar system was formed and created when asteroids, comets, and planets collide, or have collided many years in the past, are meteoroids and dust. Zipping along at faster than 20 kilometers per second, about 12 miles per second, some as fast as 50 kilometers per second, these small pieces of rock and dust crisscross the solar system and pose a potential risk to existing spacecraft and those we might send outward to the stars in the future. Small meteoroids weigh between 10 to the power of minus 9 and 10 to the power of minus 2 grams and carry a lot of kinetic energy due to their extremely fast velocity. For example, a meteoroid weighing the same as a piece of sand, 0.011 grams, traveling at 20 kilometers per second, has a kinetic energy of 2,200 joules, which is about 13 times more than a 22-caliber rifle bullet due to its much faster speed. A bullet or meteoroid does damage when it hits something because its energy of motion, the kinetic energy mentioned previously, is converted into heat at the point of impact and along its path as it penetrates the material. Have you seen a shooting star? These stars are small pieces of debris that enter Earth's atmosphere at high speed and burn up as they slow down and lose their kinetic energy of motion by heating the atmosphere through which they are traveling, causing it to glow and creating the light trail we observe. Believe it or not, Earth gains 20,000 to 40,000 tons of weight each year due to infalling dust and meteors. Meteoroids are called meteors when they enter the atmosphere. And yet we still consider space to be mostly empty. Considering that we humans are extremely small when compared to the size of Earth, and Earth is extremely small when compared to the sizes of the Sun and Jupiter, and then add in the tons of dust and debris that Earth accumulates each year, one might think that the solar system is filled with a lot of mass. It is not. Though not empty, it is filled with meteoroids and dust zipping hither and yon, sometimes falling to Earth and sometimes hitting our spacecraft, causing varying amounts of damage, from minor pitting of the surface to a mission-ending collision. Potential impacts with natural space objects must be accounted for as we plan our trip to the stars. Fortunately, the locations of all the large space objects, planets, dwarf planets, asteroids, and comets, are fairly well known, and when compared to the volume of the solar system, the probability of running into one as you cross the solar system traveling at any speed is extremely low. Not so, however, with the dust and meteoroids. While they are small and widely separated, they are there and will continue to pose a risk to spacecraft. The good news is that the likelihood for one of our spacecraft, even larger ones, hitting a piece of debris that causes significant damage is ridiculously small and has only happened once with Mariner 4. Note, however, that the probability of such an impact is a function of distance travelled. And, as noted previously, the distance we have so far sent our spacecraft are extremely small when compared to the distances they will traverse in going to another star. Even low-probability events are likely to happen given enough time, and the likelihood of hitting something significant during a light-years-long voyage is high. And we aren't through discussing what is in the vacuum of space yet. In addition to gravity and light, the Sun is pumping tons of hydrogen and helium across the solar system at speeds between about 185 and 500 miles per second in something called the solar wind. If the solar wind radiation reached Earth's surface, it would severely damage the biosphere and life within it. Earth's magnetic field serves as a shield, redirecting the material around the planet so that it streams beyond it. The force of the solar wind changes Earth's magnetic field so that it is compressed inward on the sun-facing side and stretched out on the night side. These fast-moving particles also cause damage to electronics and can completely disable spacecraft over time or quickly, especially during a solar storm, a period of increased radiation emissions from the sun. In other words, when the sun burps and spits out higher energy, higher density radiation in clouds larger than Earth that then move outward from the sun and could impact our planet, our spacecraft, or both. Space mission planners design spacecraft electronics to be radiation resistant, but it is not possible to make them immune to the radiation's effects. Given enough time, most spacecraft electronics exposed to solar radiation will fail. The solar system and interstellar space are filled with magnetic fields. As known physical processes allow Earth's molten iron core to generate a magnetic field for our compasses to use in pinpointing north, so too do they allow the Sun to create an enormous magnetic field that extends far out into space, encircling all the planets in the solar system and beyond. The combined interaction of the solar magnetic field and the solar wind define the heliosphere, the edge of which is called the heliopause, where the Sun's outward-flowing radiation pressure is balanced by the inward-coming radiation pressure flowing across deep space from all the other stars in the Milky Way. The heliopause is considered by many, but not all, to define the boundary between the solar system and interstellar space. These interstellar magnetic fields play a role in the development of another component of the interstellar medium, galactic cosmic rays, GCRs, highly energetic charged particles that permeate space. GCRs were most likely formed when stars elsewhere in the galaxy exploded and sent huge clouds of highly energetic and ionized atoms out into space, where they were further accelerated by the interstellar magnetic field to even higher energies. There are not many of them, but over time they can destroy electronics and damage biological life. GCRs and their impact on interstellar starships will be discussed further in Chapter 7. And then there is interstellar hydrogen. The heliopores, described earlier, is where the outward pressure of solar radiation, which is mostly hydrogen, is roughly equal to the inward pressure of the radiation from all the other stars in the Milky Way. This means that the interstellar space surrounding the solar system is filled with hydrogen emitted long ago from other stars and celestial objects. The density is low, with interstellar space averaging about one hydrogen atom per cubic centimeter. If you are traveling very rapidly, these hydrogen atoms become nearly indistinguishable from the high-energy protons flowing outward from the sun. There is no difference between a slow-moving spacecraft being bombarded by fast-moving hydrogen atoms, as from the sun, and a fast-moving spacecraft plowing through slow-moving hydrogen atoms. This diffuse cloud of atoms might just play a role in the viability of at least one advanced propulsion system that will be discussed in later chapters. Now that we better understand what's out there, there are many questions that need to be answered. Among them are, how will we learn which extrasolar planets we should visit? Which might be like Earth? Knowing the vast distances involved, and given our current understanding of physics and how nature works, how will we get there from here? We understand well the environment of deep space in our own solar system. What about when we cross the heliopores and begin our long journey through interstellar space? When and how can we make the trip? 2. Interstellar precursors. You have to learn to walk before you can run. Unknown. At this point, you may be thinking, okay, when can we go? Are there missions we can launch in our lifetimes? Unfortunately, we are far from being able to mount a journey to a planet circling another star, even the closest ones. The pace of human exploration can be summarized as one step at a time, and so it will likely be as we begin thinking about interstellar travel. When our ancestors ventured out of Africa, they likely did so by foot. Then came the domestication of animals, most notably horses, and the range of exploration increased dramatically. When some ancient innovator conceived of the wheel, the range increased yet again, as did the ability to carry along the goods and supplies that were essential to building early civilization. The innovations kept coming, with wheeled carts evolving into wagons, trains, and eventually modern automobiles. Travel by water also transitioned from being limited by the range of a human swimmer to canoes, boats propelled by human labor, oars, sailing ships, and the fossil fuel and nuclear-powered ships the size of small cities like those part of modern economic supply chains. The transition to flight was even faster. The first kites were thought of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.